Town of Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. First item on the agenda is minutes of the previous meeting. Any corrections? Anyone? Motion then to...
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the meeting, the minutes of the last meeting as written.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Correspondence. Let's see. In the packet, there was a memorandum from the town manager regarding the Poor Farm Committee, letter from the town of Lemoyne, DEP site law change, excuse me, DEP site law rule changes, letter from F. Levitt regarding Highland subdivision, letter from the town attorney regarding voting procedures, letter from town manager regarding Highland subdivision, zoning news, November 1996, letter dated November 12th from the Sprague Corporation regarding scenic overlays, I believe. And also on the podium tonight is a letter dated December 16th from the Sprague Corporation regarding the same subject. With that, we're on to the first item under old business. As in the past, I have to excuse myself from this particular item. And...
Mr. Chairman, I also have to recuse myself.
Okay.
My recommendation to the board this evening is for Mark Wilcox to chair this this first piece of business here on the agenda this evening.
I agree.
I will gladly take on the duties. Thank you. The first item on tonight's agenda is the Highlands subdivision, Phase 2B and 2C, a request by Peter Kennedy for approval of the performance guarantee for Phase 2B and 2C, and also located in the vicinity of Hunts Point Road Extension under Section 16-2-5, amendment to a previously approved subdivision. In order to begin our review of this application, is there someone who could come to the podium and give us an overview and explain what the application is at this point?
Glad to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you very much. At this point in time, the board can discuss the pending application, and I'd like to give board members at this point a chance to ask any questions that they may have.
Mr. Wilcox?
Yes, Mr. Carter.
Mr. Kennedy, is there going to be any construction at all through the winter season?
Of the next phase?
Yes.
I'd like there to be, yes.
And when do you anticipate the roads being completed?
Completed? I would guess around July or August.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, when is the date on this letter of credit, the expiration date? Do we have that here?
I think you find it in the draft letter from the attorney.
And this letter of credit would be for $212,000? Is that what you're...
No, I think the letter has been amended. Mike McGovern's wishes to, I believe, $278,000 as per the former town engineer's recommendations.
As per the town manager's letter, I think, too.
I haven't seen
it. I guess that's what it was, yeah. Okay. Do you at this time have any schedule of construction at all, of anything at all, any idea when you might start? These are 10 pieces of property, is that correct up there?
And there are 10 lots remaining.
10 lots?
Right. I'd like to commence roughing in the road in the first week of January.
How have you been doing on the lower end down there? Is that pretty well set up?
Yes, sir. We basically pulled out of the site and buttoned everything up for the winter, including some further erosion control, and we mulched all the disturbed areas and really button it up for the winter. The emergency access is available for the town. The water line is connected into Hunts Point. The electric telephone lines are in.
So I understand the letter of credit will be for $279,000.
Correct.
The other thing is that the town attorney had suggested a little bit different first paragraph, as I recall reading this earlier. Have you seen that?
I have not, but my banker has been in touch with both the town manager and I believe the town attorney and has agreed to the language change. There, I think the town manager has a letter to that effect.
Thank you.
Mr. Kennedy.
Yes.
Seeing a chance here to put in a few questions of my own, I was wondering if you could help me out with a
sure.
few things. The lots in this phase, are these lots at present time included in the approved subdivision and recorded at the registry of deeds and all of that legal work, has that been taken care of at this point?
The plan was recorded with all the lots in their entirety.
Okay. As far as the work goes, which is being contemplated within Phase 2B and 2C, at this point in time, are you envisioning any changes from the previously shown approved plans?
The only thing I would like to change, and I don't know if it's appropriate, is to build the roads according to the new standards, but I guess that's the town's call. The standards have changed since the subdivision was approved. Like to, in perspectives, is to go with
perhaps for our benefit, we might, and for the benefit of people in the audience and at home tonight, maybe I could take a stab at explaining those, and perhaps Maureen could help me out on the technicalities. 2 years ago, I believe, at this point, or at least when you're going to a little vague, The planning board redrafted road standards in Elizabeth in an effort throughout the town to address the phenomenon of need in the town to construct new roads according to the sizes of the neighborhoods and the number of cars and people that were being served. And by and large, I believe in this type of street that we're, proposed street that we're dealing with now, it would result in a slightly narrower street, which would have less overall impact on the surrounding landscape. Exactly how much?
Well, I believe the current roads are supposed to be 24 feet wide.
I thought 22.
Okay. They'd be dropped down to 20 feet wide. The site horizontal and vertical alignment would also be reduced somewhat, so there would be where you're rising up into that land, there would probably be a little less need for cut and fill, but if you were going to change the roads beyond just the width, and you were going to look at those kind of cut and fill issues, there would be a need for some re-engineering of the roads.
Mr. Kennedy, are you agreeable to the re-engineering of the roads?
Yes, depending on, I guess, Public Works Director and what he feels is appropriate. I know I was buying to put islands in the cul-de-sacs, which I believe he would appreciate also, but we did not do it on the Channelview Road end. Consequently, we have a 100-foot diameter paved cul-de-sac serving one house, and it's a sea of concrete. I would like to see landscaped islands in the cul-de-sacs.
Mr. Kennedy, I have another question. If these things are possibilities for the design of the subdivision of the work, which may eventually get put in place, have you given any thought to proposing an amendment to the subdivision, the approved subdivision, before going forward with letter of credit and construction? How would you sequence those?
I would propose building the roads as per the approved plan. But if I had an indication that the town were receptive to the changes and, in fact, wanted the changes, and it weren't going to take 6 months to accomplish the changes, because I think it would be better for the neighborhood and the town in the whole, I would like to, I would proceed with the process, but if it's going to be a long, drawn-out thing, I really can't afford to wait and pay interest and overhead, and it wouldn't be financially sound policy on my part. So if the town is receptive and Public Works likes it and town planner likes it and the board endorses it, then I would go forward.
Okay. For the benefit of those watching, I might interject that my question, I'm sure you understand this, has to do with where the line is drawn between a de minimis change to an approved subdivision and an amendment to an approved subdivision. And after the fact, de minimis change is something which is minor and does not involve lot count or lot size or major re-engineering, if you will, and is something which can be approved on our consent agenda, whereas actually changing a subdivision is an amendment process, which then sort of opens up a new application, if you will, and causes, I think, what you're mm-hmm. describing as a process which takes a little bit longer.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Mr. Kennedy, on the construction of the development of this area, the roads will be completed before any house construction starts?
Typically, the roads are roughed in with gravel surfaces, and then the construction trucks come in. Not all the houses are built. And from a public works standpoint, they would appreciate that, because the gravel, like on the emergency access road, I was directed not to put the final course of gravel on for quite some time, because we know it's going to be beat up and that it's going to be a town-dedicated road, and the, all the construction vehicles for the next road building in sequence access the emergency access road, and it'll pretty well tear apart a town road, so I was directed not to proceed further than I have, and I'd be willing to do that and bring the new phase roads to the same state, and if the Public Works Director wants me to pave it, finish it, and dedicate it prior to a majority of the houses being built, I'd be glad to do it.
Now, are you comfortable with this December 20th, 97 of the completion as stated here?
Yes.
Now, December 20th almost leads us into what has happened this year, where we got into bad weather and we got over until, you know, now we got to wait till spring to finish the lower, the other area down there. And now this is December 20th of 97. And I just hope that, you know, that it's done. You know, we've had some past performances and we're, I think you can understand why, at least myself, kind of hesitant about some things, but you do have the line, the letter of credit, and I just would like to know, now you've just stated that you are comfortable with the completion date of December 20th, 1997.
I am.
Thank you.
Mr. Kennedy, one of the in the outline for the performance guarantee, the paragraph in the zoning ordinance refers to the attachment to the application and the letter of credit, the attachment of a schedule of the work. Would you be able to provide a schedule of the work within a short amount of time following this meeting?
I could provide the schedule prior to starting construction.
Okay.
And I'm sure that the new town engineer will want a pre-construction conference, and the last time we did this, we agreed on a schedule at that meeting. In fact, I spoke to Steve Harding today, and he wants me to get him a full set of plans. He's going to be the engineer in charge of the town review, mm-hmm. and he's as soon as he's brought up to speed, I assume he's ready to go.
Yes.
I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the material submitted and the facts presented, the request of Pina Kennedy for approval of the letter of credit for Phase 2B and 2C of the Highland Subdivision located north of Hunts Road be approved with one condition, that a schedule of construction be submitted to the town planner and the town manager prior to any work beginning.
I'll second that.
Is there any discussion?
No.
I have one item for that I noticed in the letter of credit, which I think just may be an issue of semantics, and I might want to ask Maureen to follow along with me on this. On the second page of the letter of credit, at the end of the first paragraph, at the top of that page, item D, refers to notice by the holder of the letter of credit to the town. And it states that this notice must be given, and the last phrase in this sentence is, within 30 days of its expiration. That's in case this date changes. The ordinance, the language in the ordinance, I'm questioning the word within here, because the language in the ordinance says at least 30 days, but no more than 90 days, establishing a window, if you will, where if the holder of the letter of credit is going to change or be reassigned, that has to happen at least 30 days prior to that event taking place and not within 30 days and when that event takes place. So I would like to suggest that that be clarified.
Can I replace with the language in the ordinance?
Yes.
Okay.
That would be good.
And you want that treated as a second condition?
Yes, I would like that as a second condition. Does that sound reasonable, Mr. Kennedy?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Is there any further discussion?
None.
Hearing no further discussion, I will at this time call for a vote. All in favor of the motion, raise their right hand. All opposed? The motion passes. Thank you very much, Mr.
Thank
Kennedy.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Mr. Wilcox. Next item on the agenda under other business is proposed zoning ordinance, request by the Town Council for review and comments on the proposed zoning ordinance, section 19-4-9. This will be a public hearing. And would you like to give us an introduction, please?
Certainly. The proposed zoning ordinance, which you have in front of you, which is in a yellow cover, reflects all the changes that have been made to date, including the requested amendments that the Planning Board asked for at the workshop 2 weeks ago. The new ordinance was written after a process which included 36 meetings with the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee, 8 meetings which were jointly held between the Town Council, the Planning Board, and the Zoning Ordinance Committee members. There will be a Planning Board public hearing, which has been scheduled for this evening, and the last stage in the process is another public hearing, which would have to be held by the Town Council. The ordinance was written primarily to make it user-friendly, internally consistent, and cohesive, so most of the changes in this document are mainly reformatting changes. However, there are some substantive policy changes, and I can summarize those 5 areas very briefly. The first one would be the proposal for a new Residence B zoning district, which would be a medium density zoning district. Any development in that district other than an additional single lot would be subject to the new open space zoning requirements, which are an embellished form of our current cluster provisions, and they require an aggressive clustering format where at least 40% of the land area is set aside as open space. Those areas in the town which are proposed to be rezoned RB are shown in the blue on the map that's in front of you. Those areas correspond with the areas identified in the comprehensive plan as growth areas. The second major change is the proposal for 3 scenic overlay districts. Those are scenic roads, scenic views, and scenic areas. This is a proposal that comes out of the visual assessment report that was done by the town in 1989, and several of the areas identified in that report have been included in these 3 scenic overlay areas. The proposal basically requires that if development is to occur in one of those areas, it would need some type of review so that impact on the view that is to be protected would be minimized. The scenic roads areas identified by the heavy dotted line on the proposed zoning map. Scenic views are identified in the map right behind the podium, the blue areas. And the scenic areas are Richmond Islands and the Spurwink Marsh, and they're shown in a gray hatched area on the proposed zoning map. The third proposal is for a historic protection of archaeological and historic areas, and the town has come up with a list of locally historic structures. If a property owner wished to demolish a portion or all of one of those structures, they would be required to wait 45 days prior to receiving their demolition permit. The intent of this provision is to allow private efforts to look at whether or not the area should be saved, but in no way is this intended for the town to intervene in terms of saving a lift structure on this list. The only burden it places on the homeowners is, again, that they have to wait the 45 days, and they have to provide public notice of their request for a demolition permit. The fourth area is the proposal of a new overlay district called the Great Palm Watershed Overlay District. It covers the area basically bounded by Fowler Road, Ari Beach Road, and Ocean House Road, and it requires that landowners in that overlay district basically follow best management practices, that they would try not to tear up their entire lawn, they only do it in parts, and there are some limits that are set on the amount of impervious surface that can be covered in that particular area. And finally, the public access waiver standards, which are currently in the ordinance, have been completely rewritten so that lots on private roads which meet town standards and have sufficient frontage would no longer need planning board review. One additional lot could be created by a homeowner with a private access waiver, and if more than one lot needed to be created without the necessary frontage that's required by the ordinance, the private road standards and subdivision ordinance would have to be adhered to, and there would be review by the planning board. Tonight's public hearing not only addresses the zoning ordinance, but also the proposed maps, and if the board is comfortable with what has been proposed this evening, the next step would be to recommend it to the town council. Any questions?
Thank you very much. With that, we'll open the public hearing. Those wishing to speak, please come up to the podium and state your name and address and speak briefly as to what your concerns may be.
I am John Green, property manager for the Sprague Corporation. I think most of you recognize me from those long meetings we had over the past few months. Tonight, I would like to offer a comment per Jeanette Hagen's letter, president of the corporation, and I as a representative of the Sprague Corporation. We support the idea of producing a more consistent and readable ordinance document, but cannot support the scenic aspects of this proposal, regardless of the location, whether it be our property or elsewhere in the town. We feel that these scenic districts are intrusive and burdensome on a property owner's rights. Should the town wish to protect scenic views across private property, it should be willing to compensate landowners more appropriately. Thank you.
Thank you. It's a public hearing. You're, please.
The entire book.
Stated that, yeah. Okay, something was going to be discussed in the planning board meeting later, so I didn't know. My name is Elise Thibodeau. I live in Freeport. My husband and I own a piece of land on a private road here in Cape Elizabeth. We purchased this land, unfortunately, 9 years ago, and are very interested in helping others avoid the hardship we have been through since we purchased it. We are very much in favor of the movement towards simplifying the process of acquiring a building permit on an already existing private road. We do have concerns, however, about Article Number 2 in Section 19-7-9, which asks for legally binding agreements to provide for long-term maintenance of the road. I did speak with an attorney in the last few days regarding this issue. He, at this point, preferred to remain unnamed, as he could not address this as formally as time would have allowed. I did, however, bring his thoughts on the matter, as they are much more succinct than I could even state. I'd like to read them if that's possible. I quote, "It is questionable whether the requirement set forth in subsection 2 of proposed section 19-7-9 is sound from a policy standpoint. The requirement that a developing landowner who seeks a building permit obtain a legally binding arrangement for the long-term maintenance of the private road delegates too much power to the neighboring landowners. Through refusal to enter into a legally binding arrangement to provide for the long-term maintenance of the private road," he's very long-winded, I think, but "these landowners can effectively preclude the development of other lots in the area. Whether due to personal dislike of the developing landowner, distaste for the proposed development, lack of any incentive to formalize an existing informal maintenance arrangement, or mere whim,
the recalcitrant neighboring landowner can halt the development. Such a requirement places too much control and an unchecked veto power in the hands of these property owners. While the requirement may legitimately serve the town's interest in many situations, it also must be recognized that there are and will be situations where the requirement will not serve its purpose. The town should consider an alternative to this requirement to prevent neighboring landowners from having too much control, such as authorizing the town to impose as a condition to the granting of the building permit that the developing landowner contribute a pro rata share of the cost of the maintenance of the road. From our own personal experience with Cape Elizabeth, a similar request was made regarding our land. We were asked to get a legally binding agreement with all abutters to the road that they would not park in the road. We went door to door unsuccessfully. People were away, not at home, or as we have been told in one case, the person never answers the door. Later, we sent certified return receipt mail to each of the half dozen abutting landowners. All received the mail and signed for it. One responded favorably. One was afraid, quote, to get involved, and after much discussion, finally agreed. One party had his home overtaken by a bank, and they would not sign anything. One was in Florida for 6 months. When they returned, they did not respond to a second request. One person does not function with the world, and one party, who is adjacent to our land, had tried to buy our land at a previous price that was dirt cheap, expressed that they hoped we would never get it so that they could buy at a price that they could afford. If you need to be certain that the road be maintained, then possibly you could require any new party acquiring a permit to either contribute a pro rata share, as this lawyer suggested, or give them the option of agreeing legally to maintain it themselves. At this point, because of this and one other condition in the old ordinance concerning visibility where the private road meets the public road, should we sell our land for exactly what we had paid, we will have lost $54,000. The cost of pro rata share or even the total cost of plowing the road would be significantly less. I feel certain that an easing up of the regulations, particularly for private roads which already have houses located on them, could only benefit Cape Elizabeth environmentally and aesthetically. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mark Woodward, 96 Wells Road, and I wanted to just speak briefly about the scenic overlay zone. It is of some concern. I feel that my property might be included in that overlay zone, and am somewhat concerned about the restrictions that would be placed on me as a result of that. I'm not sure that, I think my personal feeling is that as you become more and more restrictive, it becomes less and less comfortable for an individual and their right as a property owner to use their property as they see fit. In theory, it's a nice idea to preserve the views, and certainly someone would buy a piece of property on Wells Road to enjoy views. But I think that this is potential of becoming a very expensive situation for a homeowner wishing to make any changes to his property. The process of documenting his changes and what he wants to do and going through that process could be it could be expensive, it could be time consuming, and it could be very restrictive. And I think that this needs to be carefully considered. And I say that particularly in light of all the recent conversations that have been going on about making Wells Road wider and increasing shoulder widths and doing things or changes to the road that are contrary to the character of the road as it is. So on one hand, we've been looking at changing the character of the road, which is the immediate environment, and yet imposing on a landlord or a landowner their restrictions on their property and the views across it. So I think that there's some consistency here in how we're looking at the use of property, what is in fact scenic, whether it is the edge of a narrow road where the grass and the trees come up close to the edge of the road, or whether we're talking about long views across someone's property and restricting their use. I'm very concerned about this, and I really couldn't support it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Harold Olson, 98 Wells Road. I too feel like the representative said from the Sprague Corporation, it places too much of a burden, the view shed places too much of a burden on the property owners and is in effect taking his property or a portion of it without compensation. I think it should not be passed.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak at this point in time? With that, I will close the public hearing. Okay, the procedure from here is, as I understand it, we are to at least discuss the items that have been brought forth from the public hearing and see how we, what our response is. Correct?
That's one way to handle it.
Okay. Anyone want to speak to any of the comments made by the public?
I think I'd like to address a couple of issues. One is the private road and the other is a scenic overlay. Maureen said at the outset that this was not a committee that sat down and contrived new policy out of thin air, that this process is part of the comprehensive planning process that was almost a two-year process. And the revision of the ordinances and the various reports that have been provided have all served as background information to the development of the ordinances we have it today, and primarily this has been a restructuring of the ordinance. The private road issue was a very, very difficult one. I think we heard tonight something that we didn't hear in the committee meetings, at least I didn't hear in the joint meetings. But also raises another issue. If members or people living on private roads are that dysfunctional as a neighborhood, so to speak, then certainly it leaves the town in a very difficult situation when it comes time to maintain those roads and repair those roads. And I believe that's the major impetus behind requiring that a maintenance agreement be entered into. It's unfortunate that in most development, it's the last person in who ends up bearing the major brunt of the burden of proof and having to pay for certain improvements regardless of what's gone on before them. In the most fair situation, the last person in gets to submit a pro rata share, and I think that's probably a good way of resorting or resolving an issue similar to this. However, as we've said at many planning boards, and I personally stress, the whole issue of private roads and impact on people's, what they sense as a private way of life is a very significant issue in this community. It's probably contributed to most of the development, not most, but a major portion of the development, public access waivers, and will continue to do so. We heard just a month or so ago about an individual who had sold property to and a butter using a public access waiver and now was trying to sell another property. The butter that brought the first parcel was against the new development. These issues don't tend to arise piecemeal like this if we're using a standard subdivision process. But the goal of the private road standard is to allow development within Cape Elizabeth using windy, narrow roads that preserve the Cape's character. So I think there's some give and take in the situation, but I there's no answer. There's no answer to the issue that Ms. Thibodeau raised. But certainly I was very interested to hear it. I don't know. We could get Bob Malley to come in and sit down and tell us how many times he gets a call to go out and repair private roads and whether or not that's a significant issue. My sense is that it is because nobody owns a road. It's private. But no one really knows who owns a road, and I believe that was one of the main concerns behind this type of policy. With respect to the overlay district, one of the major issues here was that the comprehensive plan recognized certain areas of town that were absolutely critical to the protection of the rural character of the community. Those views, a lot of them were at Wells Road, a lot of them are undeveloped areas. Everybody that moves into this community moves in. And we hear time and time again they love the rural character, they love the small community, and as with anything else that happens accumulatively, the impacts are not noticed individually, but at the end of 5 years, suddenly the whole character of an area is lost. A lot of the subdivision development that occurred in the '80s happened in wooded areas where there are a lot of trails that are no longer there. People who are moving in there now will never recognize the loss, but certainly people who lived in those neighborhoods 20 years ago or 30 years ago do recognize the development impacts. So another way that a community can allow, as Cape Elizabeth does, it is virtually all zoned residential, much of it zoned residential. What it can do is recognize those assets that tend to make the community as valued as all of the residents seem to feel that it is, and they reflect in the comprehensive planning process, and then try to put some guidelines on the development in those areas. And I guess I'd like to use an example of anyone who's driven down Spurwink Road or Bowery Beach Road from Cape Elizabeth to Black Point Road in Scarborough. You see continually houses being developed along the side of that road. There's no scenic overlay there, and the whole character of that road is changing dramatically and has changed over the last 20 years. But most recently what I've seen is houses starting to develop in the Pine Pleasant Hill Road area, where the house has placed a septic system within, it's just 10 feet off the right-of-way, but they've cleared every tree out of the right-of-way, mature trees, small trees. And that has absolutely destroyed the rural character and one of the reasons people come to Maine and want to live here. So we're sort of damned if we do and we're damned if we don't. I think this is a very vigorous attempt and trying to be as fair as possible to deal with this issue of what people see as some of the most critical resources in protecting the rural character. If you look at the ordinance carefully, it allows for development. It states sort of the things that are what I would think would be a good practice along Wells Road or any other scenic area in terms of taking care to, in cutting trees and so forth within the right-of-way. But I would encourage everyone, and you probably don't even need this encouragement, but who have a major issue with this issue of property rights with respect to any part of the ordinance, to voice that directly to the council. I think that's something that the council, the committee certainly are very concerned about, and the council heard loud and clear, and certainly was part of the last referendum that the state of Maine had on forestry. So that's all.
Thank you. Any other comments? Let me jump in here just for a second. I too was a little surprised about this, and maybe I missed the particular meeting that the road maintenance agreement issue was discussed during all the reorganization of and rewriting of the zoning ordinance. This sort of caught me by surprise. Could you give us a little background on that? It's kind of bothering me.
Okay. Currently, when someone has a lot on a private road or a lot on a public road with inadequate access, inadequate frontage on an accepted town road, they all have to go to the planning board for a public access waiver. But in the committee where this was worked on, there was agreement that, in fact, there are lots of existing lots out there that are on good private roads where they really don't need to have that public access waiver review by the planning board. It's a good private road. There's never been any problem with access. In a lot of cases, it's an existing neighborhood. And if all those other people are accessible to the fire truck, then what's the problem with one more house going on this road? So what happened is we took the existing public access waiver standards and we broke them up into a couple of different pieces. And it's only certain pieces that now go to the planning board. What this piece saying here, and it starts on page 139, is that if you have an existing private road and you have a lot on that road and you can show that it's a good road and it's going to be maintained, you can get a building permit. You don't have to go to the planning board. What it says, and I say good road, but I'm kind of summarizing, it's saying that you have to get a recommendation from the fire chief that the road provides adequate all-season emergency access for existing and proposed use, one. And two, you have to show that there are legally binding arrangements that exist to provide for the long-term maintenance of the road. One of the suggestions that the member of the public suggested is that if the, why are we requiring someone to have to speak to all the owners of the road, and one of the things they could offer to do is maintain the road themselves. This allows for that. There's nothing here that says that you have to make all your neighbors agree to maintain the road. If you sign an agreement saying you will keep the road clear, then that would be a legally binding arrangement exists to provide for the long-term maintenance of the road. This is really an issue of people living on a road that the fire truck cannot get to. And it's a real basic situation. I had a call from the fire chief just the other day, concerned about people building in areas where their driveways aren't wide enough. And he's concerned he can't get the ladder truck up there to put the fire out. They're not going to be able to get down an impassable road if someone needs the rescue. So that's the whole motivation behind this. There's nothing in terms of bringing these roads up to town standards. Then there's another section, it's Section B, where it talks about new private roads, and it says that if you're going to build a new private road, that you've got to build it so that it meets the private road standards in the subdivision ordinance, and you have to show that there's a legally binding agreement that it's going to be maintained in that fashion. So this whole section goes on in that light, but I think that, does that answer your question?
It does. I guess the, if I heard Ms. Thibodeau correctly, it sounds like she's in a situation where she has the seventh lot on a seven-lot road. She hasn't built on her lot yet, and she is not able to do this without going to the town and actually signing a legally binding road maintenance agreement. So then, in theory, her six neighbors could say, well, we know what you had to do. Now we don't have to contribute anymore to the upkeep of this road, and she's stuck.
Ms. Thibodeau and Mr. Zorsky received a public access waiver from the Planning Board, I believe it was in 1989 or 1990. I believe it's seven conditions were attached to the public access waiver for a road that was approved at 11 feet wide. Ms. Thibodeau has come back to me on many occasions over the years, and my recommendation to her was that if the Planning Board placed a condition on her approval, which she does not feel she can meet, that she should return to the Planning Board and ask for them to grant relief from that condition. I've also suggested that before the Planning Board would grant relief from a condition, they would want some evidence that someone had made an effort to comply with the condition. My recommendation to her has been to come back to the Planning Board, and she's chosen not to do that.
Okay. I don't think any of us really know the details of what...
I do.
Well, I'm sure you do, but no one on the board does. But given, you know, the looking at the surface of the problem as opposed to the actual problem itself, what I, at the risk of sounding redundant, what I said just previously, it does seem somewhat onerous for the last person in. Let's just take an example. There's some street off of another street someplace where it's been a private road there for 35 years, and someone decides to sell a lot that they've been holding. They sell the lot to someone, and all of a sudden they're faced with this issue of having to maintain this road that may be, you know, as much as 3,000 or 4,000 feet long. And plowing that on their own and knowing that they have to get out. It just, it seems like there needs to be something else here to help someone out in a situation like that. That's my only comment. Any other comments from any board members? Given the number of people that, and it's far less than I expected, but still the number of people that spoke to the scenic overlay, is there any more discussion that we could have, or is there something we could address that maybe might, allay some of the fears that people seem to have regarding this? And I'm not sure if there is, I'm just Is there any suggestions from any of the board members that,
Mr. Chairman?
It's all in perspective?
We asked the same question at one of our workshops, and Maureen did a very good job of explaining to us that the scenic overlays didn't really prevent anyone from doing anything with their land. They could still build, they could still develop it, they just had to do it with a reasonable amount of common sense in regards to the value of the scenic overlay. It might mean moving a house 25 feet, it might mean keeping some trees, it might mean locating a driveway down a boundary line rather than right smack dab in the middle of their frontage. And that's the way I remember it, and that's why I'm still comfortable with it, mm-hmm. is we weren't preventing a private landowner from developing their land.
Yeah. Mr. Chair, I tend to think of it as sort of a horizontal analogy to a long-established recognition upon intrusion into private property rights of the town being able to put height limitations down. It's been long recognized that everybody realizes that, you know, 60-foot high structures in a town are not in the public interest or the public good. Scenic areas in town being developed with, large, excessively large houses with only 20 feet between the houses totally blocking what used to be scenic views is not in the interests of the town either. And the mechanisms which have been incorporated into the proposed language, I think, provide for the ability for lot owners to exercise property rights, but also to keep in mind that there are other issues at hand also.
Thank you. Any other comments? Mr. Emery?
Mr. Parker, I guess I'll just close by saying that this is an enormous piece of work. It's very complex because it's dealing with very complex issues. This is a community where, since I've been on the board, I've heard neighbor disputes that end up in lawsuits where someone's put a dormer on a house that was done with a building permit and someone wanted 30-day public notice or something to that effect. And in another case, someone built a three-car garage which ended up blocking a view to the ocean of a neighbor. I mean, just perfectly good sense, kind neighbor to a neighbor situation would have avoided the three-car garage blocking the view of a brand-new house, but there was some bitterness going on between the two properties. In the best of all worlds, we wouldn't have to legislate all of these good neighborly deeds. We've seen chain link fences installed in very rural areas because of a boundary dispute, totally out of context and totally destroying the natural effect of that area. Anything that you think is never going to be a problem will be a problem, will end up before the planning board. So I think one of the main concerns that we have with this redraft, other than to make it user-friendly and consistent throughout, is to try to provide a tool by which the town can continue to grow and neighbors can continue to enjoy each other, and we can anticipate the type of development and the development impacts within the community while encouraging additional development through growth areas. So it's as much a management tool as anything else, but no one should be deceived to think that because this has been rewritten, it's been made consistent, that it's a simple document. It requires thorough study. I'm sure each one of these board members could spend another several days and weeks going through it once again. And I would encourage everyone with any concerns whatsoever about any part of this to make those presentations to the town council. We've sat through many workshops, joint workshops with a committee of the council, and it gets to the point in rewriting some of this language where it gets very complicated and it's very much a compromise in trying to allow development, trying to be fair about property values and property rights, and yet trying to provide a tool where one can develop with respect to other individuals. Anyone who watches planning board meetings from week to week or reads about the planning board meetings in the paper understands that in some cases we have to, although we are encouraged to be customer-friendly, we never know when the bomb's going to drop and when an applicant might actually not uphold what it is that applicant intends to build or develop according to the ordinance and according to the plan submitted. So this is really the only tool we have, which is an expression of the community's wishes through the comprehensive plan, and that's one thing that we stress at all our meetings, that these are not arbitrary ordinances. They're very much the policy and regulations developed out of the comprehensive plan, which is the vision of this community developed by community members.
Thank you. Any other comments from any board member? We have a motion then?
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Emery?
Be it ordered that based on the proposed zoning ordinance and facts presented, the Planning Board recommends for adoption the draft zoning ordinance as amended and zoning map.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. All those opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you to the members of the public that came and spoke tonight, and for those of you who sat and listened. And we have a motion to...
Mr. Chairman, I have a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor, please raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Thank you all.
Thank you.